Hey, how's it going? Today we're going to be doing a quick beginner's guide to Nightshade on the Dark Age of Camelot Eden private server. There will be six sections to this video. First will be playstyle slash role, then specs, both for leveling and RVR, the realm ability choices that you have, then temp slash important stats, then your recorders, and then just some quick tips. This is a beginner guide for folks who are just coming back to the game or want a refresher on how to play, so there might be some missing information, and it's mostly focused on solo slash duo gameplay, as that's what I do most and what most stealthers do. If you have any questions about anything, feel free to ask in the comments or head over to the Eden Discord and ask in the class channels. If you're going to do that, make sure to check the pinned messages or use the search function first to make sure you're not asking some common repeat questions. Let's start off with your playstyle and role. Nightshade is an assassin, which means most of the time you're going to be running around solo or duo stealthing and trying to catch enemies off guard. It is one of the two classes on Hibernia, along with the Ranger, that have access to the stealth skill, which makes you invisible to enemy players. This allows you to go deep behind enemy lines and cut off reinforcements. In large-scale PvP, they tend to skirt around the edges of battles and pick off people trying to get back to the Zerg. They also tend to hang around various common travel routes, such as docks, porters, or outside keeps that are close to big battles. They pump out a ton of damage very quickly and utilize poisons to get off a variety of debuffs off. Nightshades are also unique in the assassin archetype with their utilization of magic. They have a base magic line that gives access to a retributive shield, a casted DD, and two instant abilities, one direct damage and the other is a dot. They do have a niche place in some visible groups as a stealth detector due to a high number of stealth groups that have been running around recently, but they are one of the best options for solo players due to their ability to pick and choose their battles and delete people and then just disappear before anybody else can notice. So let's take a look at your options for specs. Leveling specs can vary a bit for Nightshades. You can either try to play what your role would be at 50, as in an assassin, or just be basically a Blademaster melee DPS, but you also have poisons. Honestly, I'd suggest the second option, as it tends to be more consistent leveling-wise, and you can get groups easier. However, some do enjoy going high critical strike in the BGs to two-shot enemy players. Be warned, though, that the vast majority of players do not like stealthers that max out and stay in the BGs for easy fights. While you should absolutely play in whatever manner you find fun, Dark Age of Camelot is a small community, so consider what kind of reputation you might want. The Bladeshade spec for leveling is pretty simple. Just go Celtic Duel at level with Blades or Pierce next. If you have any leftover points, throw them in Poison. For the CS spec, it really only comes alive at around level 21 when you get the skill Perforate Artery. Once you get this, then it is maybe worthwhile going with the Critical Strike spec. Before that, not so much. For the CS spec, you will want to go 21 CS, then max CD. With the rest of your points, just go Blade or Pierce, whatever weapon choice you made. This will let you take out nearly 70% of people's health in the first shot, but then do a bit less damage than the Bladeshade spec afterwards. If you aren't sure how to spec at any point, you can speak to any of the Nightshade trainers and they will give you the top 5 most common specs for your level. At level 50, there are a few ways you can go spec-wise. However, there are a couple things that pretty much stay the same throughout the specs. That would be keeping your weapon spec at comp 51, and your stealth and your envenom spec at comp 50. Comp 50 or 51 means that your spec level plus the amount of plus to the skill your gear has and realm rank give. Realm rank adds 1 to every spec line each level starting at realm rank 2, making the chart look something like this. You want comp 51 in order to get the maxed out damage from your spec lines. In Envenom's case, you want comp 50 in order to use the best level 50 poisons. This means that with each realm rank you gain, you can lower your spec in stealth and Envenom, and to a degree your weapon spec as well, allowing you more freedom to spec into more CD and CS. With that being said, there are a few options for specs. They all revolve around two choices, whether you want to use Pierce or Blade, and then how much CS you want. For the Pierce versus Blade decision, it comes down to a few things. The first is that there is just better weapon selection for Blades. For that reason, most people, including myself, go this route. A big part of the weapon selection is getting an item that will have a celerity proc, which makes you swing faster and therefore put out a lot more damage. Blades has the best option for that called FSLS or Fine Steel Longsword. Meanwhile, Pierce does not have any available that aren't randomly generated drops from boss mobs, making them usually much more expensive and less easy to tailor to a temp. With that being said, any time that Pierce has is marginally better than the Blades or Celtic Duel option, making it worth it to some to factor that in to your temp. Another small factor to consider in this decision is that 39 blade spec, you get a style called Fireblade, which has a decent attack speed reduction effect. This could pretty much be a moot point sometimes, because you do have a poison that does the same thing. If you are new and lazy, I'd suggest going Blades. If you do go Pierced, though, I would highly suggest picking Lurricane, as they have a higher dexterity. When it comes to how much Critical Strike you should spec, I would recommend getting enough for PA and leaving it at that until a much higher realm rank usually. That is to say, you should probably just spec 21 CS. My recommended realm rank 3 spec would look something like this. 42 Celtic Duel, 21 Critical Strike, 38 Weapon, so Blade or Pierce, 38 Stealth, and 37 End Venom. This gives you good staying power with the high Celtic Duel and the After Evade melee debuff. It also gives you access to Perforate Artery and Backstab, letting you pop bubbles that protect the casters from first hits. It is a solid middle ground jack of all trades build. This does mean though that your critical strike abilities will not hit particularly hard, but that's a pretty fair trade-off for being able to keep fighting at a high level afterwards. As you gain realm rank with this spec, I would aim for 44 Celtic Duel to get the After Evade stun, and then slowly increase your CS spec. If you want to go for the high critical strike spec, there are a couple breakpoints. The first, obviously, is 21 for the Perforate Artery. The second would be getting the follow-up stun for the Perforate Artery at 34 critical strike. This would be something of a hybrid build that's a bit weaker in extended fights, but much better at bursting down casters and ganking. A realm rank 3 spec would look something more like this. You could also just say fuck it and go for the 50 critical strike spec. This is what my secondary spec is, and it's pretty fun to just pop out of nowhere and delete casters. I find it especially fun in the Koth game mode that runs every few hours, as extended solo fights are pretty rare there. That spec would look something more like this. I will also add some higher realm rank spec character planner links in the description if you just want to follow along with those. The other spec option to think about are your champion levels. For champion levels, it's basically mandatory to grab the magical resist line. After that, you can decide between going for maybe the armor factor buff or the parry buff line. Let's talk realm abilities. Again, there are a couple ways you can go with this, but there are a few skills that are mainstays of any Nightshade build. Purge 2 and Longwind 1 are practically mandatory for any class's first RA choice. They allow you to sprint indefinitely with an endurance potion and get out of any debilitating effect such as debuffs, poison, and most importantly, CCs. Many also choose to go further in the purge line, as when it is down, you lose a lot of your fights. You could go all the way up to purge 5 to have that 5-minute timer. It really depends on how you play. I personally keep it at purge 2 because I prefer to do more damage and am fine with just wiping and coming back. One of the other mainstays for Nightshade is Mastery of Stealth. This improves your stealth detection, allowing you to find enemy stealthers, and allows you to move much faster in stealth. I'd say that most go for at least MOS 3, as it isn't too many points and gets you moving at a less painful rate. Honestly, I personally have found it doesn't save you that often. It helps most with catching archers before they can hit you, but really most archers are maxing out their MOS, making it a bit of a moot point. It depends on what you are running into while on your runs. The RA that I personally have most points invested into is Mastery of Pain. This increases your critical hit chance, heavily boosting the amount of damage you can put out. An important thing to keep in mind when putting points into that is that your critical hit rate maxes out at 50% in PvP, so it does hit a point where more points is not useful. When ranking up on my Nightshade, I put pretty much every spare point I had into this one because I just loved being able to burst down my opponents with crits. The last of the true mainstays for Nightshade is Viper. This RA increases the effectiveness of poisons, particularly your damage poison, Lifebane. It's definitely one of the higher rank options, as it starts at a cost of 5 points per level and only increases from there. After that, there are several other good options to fill in the gaps and use once you're at a higher realm rank. Of course, there are the stat increase options such as Strength, Dex, and Quickness. Strength will let you hit harder and have a higher weapon skill, and Quickness to swing faster. I personally have a bit of a Quickness gap in my temp, so I usually put my spare points into Mastery of Quickness. And just so you know, Quickness does cap out in effectiveness at 250, so if you're already past that, not worth the points. If you're feeling a little bit too squishy, you could also put your points into Avoidance of Magic, which gives a percentage-based decrease in damage taken from magic-based abilities. Nightshades are really hard to temp, as they can benefit from basically every stat, and along with that, End Venom, Critical Strike, and Celtic Duel all require specific bonuses from gear. If you want a truly max deck temp, you must have at least 2-4 really good and high utility rogs. However, you can get by just fine with some gaps in your stats with rogless temps, as at some point, it is much more about skill and realm rank than it really is about the gear. Not that gear doesn't help a ton. The most important thing when deciding what temp you want to use is whether you're going Pierce or Blades, as Pierce requires dexterity of the temp to be effective, while it is less necessary for your Blades temp. As always, there are plenty of already planned out temps available on both ZenCraft and on the Eden Discord. My recommendation, if you're going to try to make your own, would be to check one of those out for reference and then build off of them. If you are using a tent making program like ZenCraft, then it will automatically tell you what stats you need filled when building it, but if not, these are the ones you should focus on. Stat-wise, strength, constitution, quickness, and dexterity. Strength increases your weapon skill and damage for blades. It's also your damage modifier for your casting. Quickness is needed for how fast you can swing. As mentioned before, it does cap at 250 total, which is a good point to aim for. It should be noted that that is when including your base stat and being fully buffed. Constitution will give you more hit points, which is always good to have, and Dexterity scales your piercing damage and increases your chance to evade, making it essential for pierce and useful, but not mandatory, for blade-specced nightshades. As always, any gaps in your stats can be filled to a degree with realm abilities. When it comes to skill bonuses, you need everything but CS at the full 11 available. CS at plus 11 is frankly a bit optional, as it just adds damage when using your CS abilities. If you plan on being a full CS build, then it would definitely be nice to have. Another thing that you could do if you want is have specific items slash weapons with stealth on them that you could swap to when stealthed rather than having them built into the temp. However, this can be just a bit janky and adds another thing you have to think about. TOA bonuses are something that some of the older returning players might be less familiar with. The melee bonuses are the most important ones. Melee speed should be at least 8%, melee damage and style damage are also important, and you should aim to max them out, and armor factor is also good to have. If you want, it can also be good to get some of those casting stats in there. Some of those will just end up there because they are on some other good gear, but they are nice to have. Casting speed is nice, along with spell damage and resist pierce. Of course, the casting stacks are very optional, as casting is mostly used for interrupts more than damage. It should be noted that with TOA bonuses, the max you can get in stats is increased to 106, with 109 being possible with the addition of certain Mithyrians. Weapon choices are pretty straightforward. To start, you will want something that has a celerity proc. For blades, that means FSLS, and for pierce, that means you're going to have to go and find a good ROG. After that, you can either play it easy and stick with the same weapons, or you can switch to legendary weapons. Legendary weapons are weapons that hit for magic damage rather than physical, and they debuff for that magic damage, meaning that you can have weapons that hit for matter or cold damage rather than slash or pierce. Legendary weapon choice depends on what class you're fighting sometimes. For most, I wouldn't bother optimizing and having 12 different legendaries in your inventory based on what you're fighting. Instead, I'd just pick one or two and stick with those as your swap. If you want a debuff for your dots, then body legendary is your best choice. And if you just want a weapon that has a neutral resistance to every armor type, spirit legendaries will do the trick. Otherwise, just check out this chart for the best option for each armor type. The last thing to think about with getting your gear for your nightshade is charges. If you want to play at a high level of solo play, you will probably want to use item charge buffs with a 25% buff bonus. It gives you significantly more damage and tankiness to compete with those meta classes. The Mithyrian of Endless Demand is probably the easiest way to get maxed out buff bonus and spell duration, as it's one item that provides it all. The only downside is that it gives you a 15 second debuff, which makes you really easy to kill. This is less of a problem as a nightshade, as you can use it and then stealth until that debuff is gone. The charges that I would recommend using are Damage Add, Strength Con, and Spec AF buffs. A lot of the common stat buffs are things that don't actually have to be built into your temp, as they can be used from the inventory. For example, you can get the Strength Con buff from the Director's Ring of Anarchy slash Bedlam and use it straight from your inventory. The Damage Add comes from the Gatekeeper Bracer of Chaos or Oblivion and can be swapped on to use, and the Spec AF comes from the Director's Ring of Chaos slash Oblivion. Another important charge item to have in your temp would be having something with a hot on it, or a heal over time. There's two main items that people use for that. The first is the Madraxxus Cloak, and the other is the CL weapon. Recorder commands are the Eden devs' response to HK macros. They allow you to stack abilities and commands onto a single button and make your life a whole lot easier. Nightshade has a good number of these that are pretty useful. I'll just quickly go over the most important ones that I use on my Nightshade. The first is an evade slash anytime, a side slash anytime, a perf and backstab. And if you go 39 blades, then the ASR slash Eddie. Along with that, I have poison recorders set up. They just use the first four slots in my inventory and use slash poison to do slots 1 and 2, and then 3 and 4. To do this, just make a slash poison macro and do the same thing you would with any other recorder. The only other recorder I have set up is one with all of my CL buffs on one button, just to make it easier. Now you should be pretty set up to get going in RVR, but where should you go and how can you get better at fighting? The main thing with Nightshade is that you can pick your fights. On the Alb side, you probably shouldn't be picking fights with Friars or Necros, as they can be a pain. And for the mids, Zerks and Scalds can both be pains, because Zerk can rip through assassins, and Scalds just reset fights over and over again. That isn't to say you should never fight those classes, just know that those are the harder fights and you will be fighting an uphill battle. It's also important to know what poisons to open with. On CC heavy classes like a Bard / Sork, it might be good to open with a Snare and Disease Poison. If you're hitting a melee, start off with the ASR or weapon skill debuff. In reality, you will pretty much get every poison on your opponent within like the first three hits, but it can be pretty essential to get certain ones off on your first hit so that your target doesn't slip away from you. Save your instants for interrupts if you know the class you're fighting can kite. If you open on a scout, having your insta ready to interrupt after a slam can save your life. While it can add some damage to your opener, staying alive is more important. Really think about whether it is worth it using your instas for damage over interrupts. Another important skill to take note of is Remedy. It costs 10% of your health, but gives you full immunity to having any poisons applied on you. Where should you go as a Nightshade? A Nightshade can go pretty much anywhere as a Stealther, but here are some of the more common ones. To start, docks and common reinforcement routes. You can go to all the Duozone docks, or when the enemy realm doesn't have Benno / Bled, you can go to their Center Keep dock, as there should be plenty of people running through there. If there's a big BG fight or keep take happening, you can set yourself up in between the fight and the closest enemy keep that has an open port to catch Zergers. Duozones in general are also a pretty fun choice most of the time, especially because you can dodge the full groups that run through there. Also, a lot of solos run through this zone, giving you plenty of targets. The Duozones are Snowdonia, Yggdra Forest, and Mount Collery. You can check which zones are active by going in your quest journal and scrolling down to the Living Frontier Duozone quest. Solo box keeps are also a good choice. Be aware though that there tend to be a larger number of min-maxed sweats there. There's also a strong culture of not adding on 1v1s. This isn't something that's enforced by mods, but is a strongly self-policed rule by the community, and if you're known to add fights, then others there will actively start adding onto your fights. Alright, I think that's all I got for you, so if you have any questions, you can ask them in the comments or in the Eden Discord, and I'm sure somebody can get to you and get an answer for you. Thanks for watching, and I hope it helped.